Welcome indeed to Georgia Championship Wrestling, and what an hour we have in store for you this time. We've got some great, great action coming up, plus a special thing with the great Kabuki. We'll be talking to the mayor of Knoxville, Tennessee, about the upcoming World's Fair, which is going to be a very exciting event. The first time an event like this has ever been held in the southeastern section of the United States. We're going to be having the truly sensational athlete Gino Hernandez on a little bit later on. Jim Garvin will be here, and we will be seeing in action an awesome tag team combination of Ole Anderson and Stan Hansen. All of this and a lot more upcoming right now. Let me bring in Rod Piper, who, of course, has been studying things for...
Most important. You see, it's such a pleasure to be here, and I'm truly someone you can admire at this point, Mr. Soley, because I understand that they've allowed Bob Armstrong to come back into the TV studio because he feels now Bob Armstrong can contain himself. Now Bob Armstrong can hold his temper when Roddy Piper's around. Well, that's great, Mr. Bob Armstrong, and if you have any difficulty in holding on to yourself, don't worry, because I will be able to contain you, Mr. Bob Armstrong. After all, they did fine me for trying and pull me off them. That's fine. We'll just let it be gone, bypass. I'm better than you are. We'll just put it that way. But I would like to bring in an equal, or maybe someone even more superior in wrestling knowledge, Mr. Gary Hart, the impresario himself, Mr. Hart, as usual. It is truly, truly a pleasure to see you here today.
You don't realize, Roddy, the comment that I get from people all over the United States, all throughout the state of Texas and Ohio. People ask me, they say, you know, that Roddy Piper is just unbelievable athlete, and the people cannot wait to see you give that Bob Armstrong a beating like he deserves. And you know, the best thing is, he won't admit it. Georgia Championship Wrestling won't admit it. But you know, Bob Armstrong sends his son to wrestle.
Very good point,
Mr. Hart. I would like to, if I may, and pardon me for interrupting, Rod, but I think we had better move along. Time is of essence here. And I understand, of course, that you're going to be having a very, very special demonstration later.
Yes, shortly after this match. Roddy, this is something that I think that you will find very unique. It's going to be a demonstration of the Dragon Shy. I'll be back.
On TV?
Yes, on TV.
People are very... You're going to have that right on TV?
Right on TV. But would you do me a favor?
Anything.
I know every time Armstrong's name comes up, you sort of remember what I told you last week. Be cool, brother. You look so nice.
Outstanding. Thank you both, gentlemen. Roddy and Mr. Gary Hart, thank you very much. Let's turn it over to the ring where we get this match underway. Speaking of Armstrong, of course, we will have Brad Armstrong going up against Rick Benfield. One fall, 10-minute time limit. Brad Armstrong in the green trunks, bringing him back to the ring ropes. Good clean break, and Armstrong sizes him up once again. It is true, of course, Bob Armstrong is here today. Later on, we're going to be hearing something rather interesting, too, referring to Big John Studd. Ooh, drop kick by Brad Armstrong takes Benfield off his feet.
And there is a big man when you're talking about Big John Studd. And it was an interesting point that Mr. Hart had. Mr. Armstrong has sent his son to wrestle. I don't see that Mr. Armstrong wrestling there in a tag with his son anymore. I don't know if it's humiliation. I don't know that if he just doesn't want to realize that he has been beaten, that he has been showed up. In any case, his son still is doing a tremendous job there in that particular hip toss, and I think his son is coming right along, maybe because he's forgetting about his father.
Nick Patrick, the referee, slid down, caught those shoulders very quickly, and a good reversal here by Brad Armstrong on Benfield. Back into the ring ropes and turnbuckle, and Nick Patrick calls for the break. I'd like to welcome Cub Scout Group 90 from the Slater Elementary School here today. Also, we have a group from the Georgia Retardation Center. Bob Eberhardt brought a group down here watching the matches for the first time. A pleasure to have them here at the Television Sports Arena and here at WTBS. Now it is Benfield with that foot over the ropes, forces the break.
And it is nice to see the interest that they have when the Boy Scouts come down, a fine, fine group. And it's nice to see all these groups coming down. And it is truly a tribute to Georgia Championship Wrestling to have these groups come down and to have that much interest in it. Bob Armstrong now with a headlock on this young fella and squeezing, but I don't really think that he has all his stuff together here. Brad Armstrong, excuse me, Bob Armstrong, Freudian slip. Oh, but very good, very good.
good recovery. Tried to leapfrog. Almost lost his balance. Fine dropkick back to the headlock. He's trying to wear the man down using the headlock. However, you see, the problem is he's not doing what Roddy Piper would do. He hasn't got his legs spread quite wide enough and doesn't have all his weight on the man's head when he's got him down on the mat. And that's one of the errors these young fellows make. If they would just watch me, they would see this thing.
Brad Armstrong now with that side headlock on Benfield, keeping the pressure on Benfield, and thus far, both men have been remarkably evenly matched, and Benfield now using that knee effectively.
Very, very, very good. Now, very, very good. Nice, nice slam, nice slam. Good deep crotch hold there on the slam, which is important because if you do not have the man deep, then the man can kick his legs and go for a small baggage or some kind of a counter. Here, Brad Armstrong coming back. He is a tough little fella, you must admit that. That's fire pound for pound. You know, we're talking pit bulls. He is a pretty tough little fella.
It's interesting to hear the comment Little made about any professional wrestler. Yet in the category of professional wrestlers, Brad Armstrong using a full power slam would be considered not one of the larger wrestlers. He'll go in there at about 220 pounds in that junior heavyweight division. And there you see an outstanding victory by Brad Armstrong over Rick Benfield using a full power slam. Here you catch him in action. Now watch this intensity of this full power slam. Then he moves in for the count of three and a victory for Brad Armstrong. It's certainly a pleasure and an honor to have with us today as our special guest the mayor of Knoxville, Tennessee, Randy Tyree. And Mayor Tyree, of course, everybody, I guess, the world over is talking about the World's Fair that is coming to Knoxville.
Well, we're excited about that fact, and the last week we signed up our 21st nation that will be participating. Atlanta being close by like it is, it's going to be a tremendous, exchange of folks in terms of people from this area coming in. It's an exciting time, and the entire region is going to be impacted. This is the first time ever that we've had a World's Fair in the South or Southeastern United States, and be a lot of sports activity going on during the 6 months also.
Well, of course, I know we of Championship Wrestling are hoping to participate in the World's Fair and have a special international series of championship matches during the fair. You know, we were talking a moment ago, and you said this has been the construction of this has been undergone for the last 3 years. And certainly you and City Council of Knoxville have to be commended for your farsightedness in view of the world situation the way it is today to bring this kind of bold step forward, not only for Knoxville, but for the great state of Tennessee.
Well, it's been a struggle in some respects of the word, but the exciting thing about it is, economically speaking, we've had a tremendous advantage because, for example, our unemployment in the Knoxville area is about 3% below the state average in Tennessee, and a lot of folks have jobs that wouldn't otherwise have them. And in addition to that, the amount of international attention, we're literally going to be putting Knoxville and Tennessee on the world's map, and that's going to be significant on a long-term basis.
Well, certainly no question about that. And what about facilities? Are there going to be plenty of housing facilities for the people who are going to visit the fair?
There will be. As a matter of fact, within a 100-mile radius of Knoxville, we have over 87,000 units of housing. There are 20,000 in Gatlinburg alone, so we'll have plenty of room for the folks up there.
Well, Mayor Tyree, certainly a pleasure to have you aboard with us today on Georgia Championship Wrestling. My congratulations to you, the council, and I think the state of Tennessee is lucky to have a man like you on board.
Thank you very much. Appreciate the opportunity to visit.
Mayor Tyree, and we'll be back in just a moment. Gary Hart, of course, is a master of deception and also a master of management of great, great wrestling talent. And the great Kabuki, I think, is fair evidence of that, but a most unusual situation coming up at this point in time.
Well, as I had said before, I want to let the people understand what the Dragon Shy match is all about. And just in a moment, I am going to do everything in my power to bash Kabuki as many times as I can with this kendo stick. Now, Kabuki is going to do everything in his power to see to it that I do not hit him with the kendo stick.
This is an actual demonstration that these people are going to be privileged enough to see. And what it is you're trying to show that Kabuki, nobody could hit Kabuki any place if Kabuki, oh, that's a pleasure, if Kabuki didn't want to be hit.
That's right. Now, just for any skeptics, Garden, I've taken this opportunity. As you see, there's $100 bill. Ben Franklin, it's another $100 bill.
All right.
Just so everyone completely understands, there has been a boy chosen, one of the best up-and-coming young wrestlers in Georgia, anywhere in the United States, and I think his name is Rogers, Tommy Rogers. I'm sorry if I've got his name wrong. And as soon as I get through with Kabuki, if Tommy Rogers can take this stick and touch any part of Kabuki's body other than the Dragon Shy glove, then he gets the 200.
You see, he's so all intelligent. Right. You see, when he figures that people are going to think that he's not even trying to hit him, what he's going to do is not only going to demonstrate it himself, but he is going to have an opponent come in and give it a try right on national television. Do you know what a risk this man has taken doing this? Not a risk at all, because he has the great Kabuki.
Well, let's just watch this very, very carefully now. With the kendo stick, it's Gary Hart. And you see Kabuki watching him. He can strike him a good block. Painted again and again moves.
Beautiful, beautiful.
And he has tried now for different parts of the body. Has not been able to...
Notice the concentration on Kabuki. Hart even went for a feign there. Went for a feign, meaning tried to hit him and then abstract hit him. Perfect. Absolutely, positively perfect.
All right.
Perfect.
Tommy Rogers, I understand, is... And let's clarify a point here. Tommy Rogers is not an opponent, per se. Tommy Rogers will be coming out here attempting to, if he can, strike any portion of Kabuki's body.
What you must understand, too, Mr. Soli, is this, what Mr. Hart is doing right now is people saying, oh, yeah, why don't you try hitting him harder, Mr. Hart? So Mr. Hart has stepped aside. So much confidence in this man. Now, here's a young fellow that's going to do everything he can. Now we're going to see something right on national television. It's just truly incredible.
All right, let's watch this.
I want everyone to understand what the Dragon Shy is.
Look at this.
And he is swinging that kendo stick.
Now.
He is really moving after him now. Kabuki.
Look at that.
Blocking beautifully, I might add.
Touch the body.
He must touch the body. Thus far, he has been unable to.
It's nothing, see? He's perfect.
He got him.
Look at that.
And Kabuki suddenly retaliating there as he was caught. Kabuki, his attention diverted momentarily. And now a Kabuki using the kendo stick on Tommy Rogers.
Beautiful.
And Gary Hart trying to... Kabuki. And he is having a problem handling this man. Rogers beating around the head and shoulders as Kabuki just went berserk here once he felt the sting of that bamboo... And it could be, I think, in a sense, called a torture instrument. But nonetheless, he...
I'll tell you something, mister. I wouldn't want to be the one of the fellas that hits Kabuki with a stick. I've never seen rage in a man. Look at that Kabuki. Look at him turning circles. This is Dragon Shy on national television. Do you know what you've just seen? You've just seen history. Look at even Hart. Even Hart is having a hard time controlling this man now.
Well, I can certainly understand why. And, of course, it Kabuki, whose attention... I have to say, it was temporarily diverted, and Rogers seized that opportunity, caught him with that Dragon Shy.
Bravo. Bravo, Mr. Hart.
I have back my 200?
Well, no, I don't think you should have back your 200. The understanding, when you gave me the 200, and correct me if I'm wrong now, you said if Rogers hits any part of his body aside from the maced arms... he was entitled to the 200, and he didn't.
Did he hit any other portion, Roddy?
Just the gloves. He didn't hit anything else but the gloves.
He caught him on the side of the back. This is when he put down on it.
Okay, I'll take your word. 200's the boys. Could I have back my gold watch, though?
Your gold watch?
Yes.
Yes, of course you could have your gold watch.
Okay,
back.
So Tommy Rogers has paid quite a price for this $200, but I will see to it that he is given this $200 of the minute the show is over, sir.
I must tell you something. You're taking $200 here unnecessarily because the great Kabuki had stood in there and done his chore, and he looked back to Mr. Hart here in innocence, looked away, and that young man at that particular time nailed him in the back of the head. Now, myself, I wouldn't have gone for that, and that's exactly what happened.
He...
I say this.
Yes.
For many years, it has always been said, win if you can, lose if you must, but Tommy Rogers always cheats, Roddy. Cheaters never win. They never prosper. What's $200?
There you go. That's true. Gentlemen, what a beautiful demonstration.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Hart, the great Kabuki. And thank you, Mr. Piper. That was interesting indeed. But we do have then, of course, an admission, too, by the same token, that that indeed Kabuki was struck, as Mr. Piper so quickly admitted. Let's take a moment right now to talk about something very important. On the 28th at the Omni, the beginning here in the state of Georgia of the World Tag Team Tournament.
Wait a minute, Mr. Foley, I got something to say. Ron Fuller and Bad Leroy Brown are going to be there, and I have a little score to settle with Mr. Fuller. Nobody but nobody is going to take my mask off and not have to pay a price for it. Ron Fuller, don't worry about no World Tag Team Championship. You just worry about the Super Destroyer and his super place, because I'm coming after you.
You know, we're going to be in Columbus, Ohio. We're going to be in Dayton, Ohio, and also in Huntington. But right here in the Omni is a lot of tough teams. You're looking at the champions right here, fellas. We're coming after those World Tag Team Tournament Championship belts. Right
here, wrestling will be held tonight in... It's a super wrestling spectacular Sunday night, February 28th at the Omni in Atlanta. The beginning of the World Tag Team Tournament. $25,000 goes to the winning team. Here are the teams that have entered. Jack and Jerry Briscoe, the Superstar and Super D. Bob and Brad Armstrong, Dory and Terry Funk. Ole Anderson and Stan Hansen, Buzz Sawyer and Ron Bass. Ron Fuller and Bad Bad Leroy Brown. Tenru and the Jumbo Saruta. And you'll see the return of the Mongolian Stomper. In a special Dragon Shy match, it will be the Great Kabuki, managed by Gary Hart, going up against the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. The Pacific Federation Championship match, the Giant Baba defends his title against Terry Gordy. And then NWA World Heavyweight Champion Ric Flair defends his title against the former champion, Harley Race. All of this great action takes place Sunday night, February 28th at the Omni in Atlanta. Well, of course, on the 28th at the Omni here in Atlanta, it will be Gary Hart's Great Kabuki against the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, in a Dragon Shy match.
Let me say one thing, Rhodes. Last week you were here making light of the situation. I think everyone had the opportunity to see a few moments ago what it's all about. And in the Omni, brother, you will see what it's all about when the stick is around your head. Columbus, Ohio, Dayton, Ohio, Huntington, we're on our way.
That's Tom Pritchard of Houston, Texas, in the red and blue trunks, going up against the Golden Boy, Chick Donovan. And Pritchard comes with a fine reputation. He has a win-loss record that is weighted to the win side. Very, very swift mover in the ring. Locks up collar and elbow with the Golden Boy. Referee Nick Patrick watching him very carefully. All right, and it's the Golden Boy utilizing the ring ropes. Forces the break that time. Golden Boy went, and Golden Boy, Chick Donovan moving very quickly, but Pritchard, good reversal there, comes with the top wrist lock and scores the takedown.
Now there's a tactic, Mr. Sawyer, that's been used quite a lot, and I think referees now, they're getting they're smarter, the officials, and right here we have the best officials that you can get in wrestling. And what the guy was trying to do there, he claimed that his opponent pulled his hair, and there was no hair pulling there. But what it is it confuses, it frustrates his opponent. The referee really doesn't know what to do, and it's a good psychological move, but it's been used so much now that people are wise to it. And so you see myself being current, being progressive, I don't use that kind of stuff anymore.
Interesting observation from Rod Piper regarding some of the psychological aspects of professional wrestling. Good breakup by Pritchard. This is the thing I talked about, Pritchard. He is a versatile competitor, and now you see a look of frustration and now anger beginning to cross Chick Donovan's face. And, of course, anger is the most dangerous mistake you can make in any sport because, Randy Tyree, the mayor of Knoxville over there. He's already settled himself in watching the matches here, got rid of that blazer, and relaxing over on the far side watching the matches.
Did you see that, Mr. Sully? You know what I said about being progressive, but this Golden Boy here has managed to get his opponent mad. His opponent just yelled back at the referee, so I guess his psychology is working, isn't it?
It could be. It'll depend on who gets the pinfall.
Yeah, absolutely. And the frustration, I can see frustration in his opponent's
in his opponent's face there. I can see the referee concerned back and forth. Maybe he's got a little bit more psychology than I thought.
That's one thing, you know. There's Mayor of Knoxville, Randy Tyree. Of course, Knoxville will be the home of the World's Fair upcoming May 1st, as we discussed with the mayor a little bit earlier. Off the ropes now. Pritchard up and over his man. Good. Oh, tried for a crossbody block. Donovan was ahead of him. Caught him mid-flight. And now Pritchard move one step ahead. A beautiful arm drag takedown.
Beautiful. Absolutely beautiful move there. And you know, it's interesting. World's Fair, so much is happening. World Tag Team Tournaments, $25,000 in every time. World's Fair, the mayor from Knoxville. We got wrestlers of all the greatest caliber right here in 1 hour. And you've got me. This is amazing.
And a pleasure indeed to have Rod Piper back with us here on Georgia Championship Wrestling.
Thank you.
And you can see Donovan there trying to take a shortcut. I was talking not too long ago with, of course, Atlanta promoter Paul Jones, and we were mentioning the fact that so many wrestlers today, even though they have all of the physical attributes, all of the training, so many of them still resort to shortcuts. And, of course, that's something that he has disapproved of back when he was a great wrestler himself and now, of course, is a dean of promoters.
Yes, absolutely. You're right, sir. And shortcuts are good in ways. He says, sometimes I use shortcuts, but the thing is this. You, first of all, you must learn how to do it the long way. Once you perfected the long way, then you know which shortcuts are right. And that's what these people don't do. They don't devote the amount of time that they need to do some of them. Not the time like I have. Now, look at this. Nice, nice step over takedown. Very good. Look where he was. He's to the ropes. Very nice.
And Donovan with a quick counter there before Pritchard could get himself set after he'd scored the takedown. Donovan very quickly closes in on his man. And Pritchard now has his hands full as Donovan has thrown away that rule book momentarily. And it is Pritchard, arm whipped into the ropes, caught by Donovan mid-flight as he again tried to come up for a cross body block. Donovan now beginning. He tried to press his man, and it was Pritchard catching him. He's got him in a rolling backslide, and it is... No, sir, he got those shoulders off.
Beautiful, beautiful counters there. Beautiful counters, both going for a pin. Tried to power him up, couldn't. Guy went for a backslide, couldn't do the backslide. What competition you've got here.
And it was Donovan coming down partially on the shoulder and on the side of the hip that time, and that could create some problems. Donovan now, in a fit of rage, rips across the face, now catches him with a forearm.
Nice reversal.
Donovan caught a high backdrop, and Pritchard, eyeing his man, caught him again, and that time Pritchard was on him. Got the pinfall. So, young Tom Pritchard, as I said, who had quite an impressive streak going for him, and a very, very critical, important victory here today on Georgia Championship Wrestling as he scores a pinfall on one Chick Donovan. Well, it's a pleasure to have with me right now from the south side of Chicago, Bad Bad Leroy Brown. You know, Leroy, one thing I'd like to mention, you and, of course, the Tennessee stud Ron Fuller have become quite a highly reputed tag team combination. However, there are a lot of folks here in Georgia now referring to Ron as the Georgia stud, and I guess there's some credence to that as well.
Well, Gordon, let me tell you something. Everybody loves to come to Georgia. And let me tell you something about Tennessee stud, Georgia stud. That's my partner. And he's my main man. You know, Stud's been in wrestling a long time. With his combination of wrestling and my combination of fighting, hey, Gordon, we make a hard team to beat. And you know, Superstar and Super Destroyer, we're going to take that mask off once and for all. You know, Gordon, the time is coming down, and the time is getting close. So you tell him about it, Gordon. Come on.
Okay, fair enough. And I think we can see there, something else, though. There is another stud, and I think it bears some listening to right now. Leroy, if you'll take a look at the monitor with me, we're going to hear some videotaped comments right now from a gentleman by the name of John Studd.
Wrestling fans, a lot of exciting action coming to the Peach State of Georgia, and we want to talk right now to Big John Studd, going to be making his way down your way.
Take a good look at me. John Studd, 6'9", 340 pounds. I'm the biggest man in professional wrestling today. There's nobody bigger than me. Not Blackjack Mulligan, not Angelo Mosca, not Jerry Blackwell, not Hulk Hogan. Even Andre the Giant has to look up to John Studd. Now, I understand that there's somebody from Tennessee being called the Tennessee Stud. Well, I got a message for you, and I got a message for all you rednecks. There's only one thing that comes from Tennessee, and that's hillbillies and rednecks. I can bend steel bolts. I can bend steel bars. I take wrestlers and I leave them laying in the center of the ring in their own sweat and blood. I'll step in a ring with two, three men. Do you understand?
Well, a pretty much of an open challenge from one John Studd, Leroy.
Well, you know, Gordon, the man seemed big on calling people names. But let me tell you, Gordon, I've been called a lot of names. I'm sure it runs full of Big John Studd. You know, he come out here calling people names. I know the Tennessee Stud's been called a lot of names. But Gordon, there's one thing I learned in life. Early in life, people going to call your name. But you don't let that upset you. It's what they do in the middle of the ring. And let me tell you something, Big John Studd. Anytime, any place, you want to take on me or the Tennessee Stud, bring it on, brother, all 320 pounds, and we'll sell it right in the middle of the ring.
Fair enough. Bad, bad Leroy Brown. He and the Georgia Stud, and we heard from John Studd. We'll be back in a moment. Last week, I think the wrestling world was rather electrified when this young man, Gino Hernandez, came out and defeated Brad Armstrong. And, of course, it came as no surprise.
Mr. Soli, if you wouldn't mind, I would like to, I know your expertise, but I would like to talk to this gentleman myself because I admire him so much. When you say electrified, this man reminds me so much of the great Luthes, only the modern-day version. He is one of the greatest wrestlers I have ever seen. And, Mr. Hernandez, again, it's such a pleasure to have you here.
Rodney, it's a pleasure to be back with you. I'd just like to say, you know, after last week, like I said, it had to be, you know, connived a little bit to sneak in on the appearance there, but all the women, when I arrived again this week, were screaming and yelling at me and going crazy, as usual, something that I'm completely used to, and one of them presented me with a towel. Yeah, well, the
initials on it.
They presented this to you? A monogram towel, but the initials are TR, and all she said to me was that she had once thought of somebody else as being the most handsome man on this earth, but she had a change of heart.
Okay, I got you now.
You know, the blonde-headed punk sissy,
I got you now.
Tommy Rich.
I got you now.
Well, you know, showing that the classy person that I am, I would like to say, I can't accept a gift that was intended for someone else. So, Gordon Soli, I would like you to have this towel and present it to Tommy Rich as a crying towel as he loses the masses of his fans.
Very good.
Wow.
Man.
Some heavy comments indeed from Gino Hernandez as he moves toward the ring now. And it will be Gino Hernandez going up against Bobby Garrett. Bobby Garrett, of course, back in action now after having been sidelined with a broken arm that happened in a match against the world heavyweight champion Ric Flair. But Garrett has been training intensively, is back in the peak of condition now, and Hernandez catches him very quickly. Full arm drag and twist. Garrett reverses on him. Hernandez, good move on Hernandez's part. Slid into a drop toe hold and floated up over the body. And as he tried to get the side headlock, Garrett was ahead of him, got the hammerlock, but Hernandez makes it to the ring ropes.
Fantastic wrestling too, Mr. Soli. You see, when Hernandez got the arm, first thing he did was he took the offense. The man reversed. What a good kick! Did you see that coming completely by surprise? Took the offense. Hernandez, instead of trying to compete arm for arm, took him right off his feet, took him down on the mat. Complete control this man has. This man is truly amazing.
He's a fabulous athlete. There's no question about that. And, of course, second-generation wrestler, and this has served him well. But he has that rare combination of today's young lions that is bringing him the stardom that, very frankly, he has sacrificed to get there. And that's, I think, regardless of what you may think of a person's philosophy, the sacrifice they go through is tantamount. And Garrett now exploding on Hernandez may have him in trouble. Hernandez may find himself... Ooh! Drove that knee in very effectively.
Beautiful knee, not only catching him in the chest, but in the mouth. Absolutely perfect. You can notice Hernandez was on the defense, but never once did he stop thinking. Just waited for the fellow to make a mistake, and the boom, bow! He took over again. It's just exciting. I can't imagine how much time has been spent with this man. If you people could know and realize, just like you said, Mr. Soli, being the expert you were, the subjection that he's gone through for just punishing his own body to get where he has. Oh, it thrills me.
Crashes that elbow down across the chest. Did not allow the pin. had the man and annoyed the referee, Nick Patrick, and so Hernandez obviously here trying to make a case in point, trying to make sure everybody understands very quickly that he will punish a man. Ooh. Hernandez now crashed down across
beautiful,
the chest again.
Beautiful. Gorgeous.
A count of three, and Gina Hernandez, and quite a figure indeed, Gina Hernandez, victorious in his match and against the return of one Bobby Garrett, and Mr. Hernandez making his way now to the dressing room, and we'll be back in just a moment. They're waiting now for Jim Garvin to appear. Garvin will be competing against Rick Harris. Garvin giving away some weight, some height, some size here. And there's the bell. Garvin moves out. Harris holding that advantage, and he meets him head on. And Harris very quickly showing that superior weight, bowled Garvin back to the ring ropes. Garvin, of course, has had a brilliant career thus far in professional wrestling. And is a well-respected competitor. Harris taking a shortcut, pulling the hair, got the Garvin off his feet, but only momentarily.
Do you know where Garvin is from, Mr. Sorley? Would you have, is he a Southern boy?
Yes, he has spent a lot of his youth in the state of Florida, as a matter of fact.
I wonder if it's the coaching that is slacking a little bit. I know it's a lot of Southern boys, they have such good potential, but it just seems like some of the moves that they're trying, the coaching may be just a little flat, because just the tiniest position, an inch your hand this way, an inch your hand that way, makes so much difference, and I see it so many times and times again. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to send some films that these young fellas can watch of myself wrestling, because I'd like to help out, because this is such a wonderful program, and young Garvin, he should be one that we're watching, although he is doing a fine job himself, because right now he is against a man 280 pounds. Garvin being, I would just be guessing, maybe 230. Oh, but that 280, that does take a toll, doesn't it? It's showing you right now, too.
Well, Harris is obviously going to utilize every advantage he has, and can't blame him a bit for that, but again, we go back to the shortcuts, and as you even said, a man should learn the long way before he attempts those shortcuts. Garvin explodes one on the side of Harris's jaw. Harris catches him in the throat. Harris now with a high knee lift that puts Garvin back to the canvas.
Yes. Garvin in a little bit of trouble here. He hasn't quite learned how to deal with a man when you got a man 40, 50 pounds heavier. However, he's either going to learn or he's going to be eating plenty of beans. That's what's going to be the problem is. I think he's got him there. Hook the leg for a three. No, a two.
Good upper body movement there on the part of Jim Garvin. Powered himself out of a possible pinning combination. And it's Harris exploding one just under the chin of Jim Garvin. Now has him over that top ring rope and is punishing him even more.
Absolutely. I can see the Boy Scouts here, the Cub Scouts getting all excited here, cheering for Garvin. Garvin does have a lot of fans here in the South, and it's nice to see all these little young fellas cheering away for their whoever they want to cheer for.
Harris back to the canvas now. Garvin in the lateral press. Count of two, and Harris is able to power out. Talking about coaching, I might just mention that young Jim Garvin had some of the finest coaching available in Coach John Heath in his early career as an amateur, and has carried that, of course, coming from a wrestling family as well. Keeps that front headlock now on Harris, keeping him trapped into the canvas. In that cramped position, too, he's going to have a problem breathing.
Mr. Soley, absolutely perfect. Perfect. And what you're saying is so right. You know exactly what you're talking about all the time. And that's what I like about you. You know, you're not like some fellas that come out here and just ramble and really don't know what they're talking about. That's why I admire you, Mr. Soley. And when I was saying about his coaching, maybe what I was saying is you took it wrong. I didn't mean that the coaches weren't any good. Young amateur coaches are great, but maybe a difference in coaching is what a young man would need. Just a difference of opinion. Like films of me wrestling.
And it's Harris now again applying pressure across the throat to the larynx of Jim Garvin, giving him more and more trouble breathing. And the more problem he has bringing air into his lungs, the more problem he's going to have delivering oxygen to the brain. And, of course, when that starts slowing down, your mental processes slow down, Your reflex action goes down, and you can be in a lot of trouble.
And that's when wrestlers really, really get hurt, Mr. Scioli. It's just exactly what you said there. When they stop thinking, oh, go for a backslide. Off a hip toss, beautiful. Kick, kick, kick.
You got the pin. Got the pin. Outstanding counter by Jim Garvin on Rick Harris. Moved extremely well. Caught Harris coming off the ropes. Harris tried for a hip toss. Garvin caught him very, very nicely. Watch now, very carefully, as we see it again in slow motion. Garvin off the ropes. Notice now, tried to set him for a backdrop. Garvin hooked in on him, brought him around, and had those shoulders solidly down for the count of three. An outstanding victory for Jim Garvin.
Brad and Bob Armstrong are with me, and Brad, of course, tonight you're in Carrollton, Georgia.
Yes, sir, and tomorrow I'm going to be in Columbus and Dayton, Ohio, but the big thing I'm looking forward to is that tag team tournament worldwide, teams from all over the world coming in, and I'm just proud to be a part with my dad here at that tag team tournament.
And, of course, that will be February 28th at the Omni here in Atlanta.
World-class competition. You know, they're coming from overseas. The Japanese are sending their best. New Zealand, they're coming from everywhere. This is really world-class competition, the best Omni card I've ever remember seeing or hearing about. And like Brad said, we're both proud to be on it and hope we can come out on top.
And, of course, beginning March 8th, these two will be on the big tour, too, through Lansing, Grand Rapids, and points up there. And now here's an important word.
It's a super wrestling spectacular Sunday night, February 28th at the Omni in Atlanta. The beginning of the World Tag Team Tournament. $25,000 goes to the winning team. Here are the teams that have entered. Jack and Jerry Briscoe, the Superstar and Super D. Bob and Brad Armstrong, Dory and Terry Funk. Ole Anderson and Stan Hansen, Buzz Sawyer and Ron Bass. Ron Fuller and Bad Bad Leroy Brown. Tenryu and the Jumbo Saruta. And you'll see the return of the Mongolian Stomper. In a special Dragon Chi match, it will be the Great Kabuki, managed by Gary Hart, going up against the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. The Pacific Federation Championship match, the Giant Baba defends his title against Terry Gordy. And then NWA World Heavyweight Champion, Ric Flair, defends his title against the former champion, Harley Race. All of this great action takes place Sunday night, February 28th at the Omni in Atlanta.
Tommy Wildfire Rich, a very busy schedule, beginning with Columbus, Ohio.
Yes, sir. You know, it's Georgia Championship Wrestling on tour. Columbus, Ohio, Dayton, Ohio, Huntington, West Virginia. And, you know, there's some super people up there. And I'm really looking forward, because after we get through taking care of business, it's going to be part of time, because I've seen a whole lot of pretty ladies there, Gordon. And just like I said, I can't wait to get to Columbus, Ohio, Dayton, Ohio, and Huntington, West Virginia, and I want to say hi to all the people in Grand Rapids, Lansing, and Toledo, Ohio, because I hear we're going to be going there before long, and I'd just like to say I'm really looking forward to it, Gordon.
Well, certainly no question about that. There's going to be some great matches, and for all of you in that particular viewing area, we certainly hope you will get out to see Tommy Wildfire Rich in action. Don't forget, beginning March 8th, the swing of Georgia Championship Wrestling into Grand Rapids, Lansing, Toledo, and of course...
I believe all the mail I've been getting all of it. It's just unreal, Gordon, and I'd just like to say thank you very much for having me here, and hi to all the people all up over the north through there.
Okay, waiting now for the tag team combination of Ole Anderson and Stan Hansen to appear in the ring. And, of course, we've been talking about the great tag team tournament. Next week here on Georgia Championship Wrestling, we will have the Giant Baba. We'll also be seeing Jumbo Saruta. And the Japanese, of course, sending over the very, very top tag teams in their country to compete here on a nationwide basis. So it is going to be most interesting indeed. But here we're seeing... Timms and Rogers, or Timms and Gallagher, rather, Jim Gallagher. That's Stan the Man Hansen out of Borger, Texas. He's big, he's rugged, and he is mean.
Absolutely, Mr. Scioli. And they do have something to prove here, because his partner is Ole Anderson, who was the man that had the World Tag Team stripped from him and his brother. And there is a little bit of ego here, and there's something to prove. And these two men have been working together as a team, and you just watch them work. One never gets tired. If he just has an inkling of time, look at the viciousness. Boom, he's going to tag right away. This is going to be one of the top teams in this competition.
Well, there's certainly no question about that. When you consider that Ole and Gene Anderson, hell, there's a front chancery by Anderson. And Timms makes the tag, and Gallagher moves in.
Beautiful, beautiful. Notice him popping back and forth. He's got Gallagher by the hair. He's yelling at Stan, give me a knee, Stan. Boom, right into the knee. They're talking back and forth. Another thing, Mr. Soley, did you notice? When he had the young Gallagher there, never gave him a chance to get through the rope. Did you notice that? They are thinking and taking advantage of every position. Beautiful.
Oh, body slam by Stan Hansen on Jim Gallagher, and Gallagher, who has quite a reputation of being a brawler of the first order, is being just totally demolished here by Stan Hansen. So the bad man from Borger, Texas, making his mark in his return to Georgia Championship Wrestling. By the way, I would like to take a quick opportunity to thank all of you who have sent so many letters. Certainly, I have appreciated your comments and certainly enjoy hearing from you.
Yeah, me too.
Rear chin lock by Ole Anderson now brings Gallagher up into the ring ropes, and Anderson closes in once again. Anderson, a master strategist in the ring. And you heard Hansen say, give him a chance, but Hansen moved in with a cheap shot on Gallagher. Now Anderson closes in on him once again, and Gallagher has not had a chance to get it together at all moving into that ring. A series of percussions to his body, plus Anderson has very effectively covered him up when he's trying to breathe. And again, taking away that air supply.
Perfect, Mr. Soley, perfect. Notice how he corners him against the ropes, doesn't give him a chance to move, keeps listening to the count, knows he's got 4 seconds in there, smothering the man, keeping the hands, not jabbing the fingers in there, just keeping the hands. A little teamwork now, 1,001, 1,002. No, they're not touching him now, are they? So now there's no chance of disqualification. Perfect teamwork.
Hansen catches him again, uses that massive forearm, then the elbow, and Gallagher makes the tag with Ed Timms. Timms, was that a chance for a respite? Continues to take even more punishment from Stan Hansen.
Again, as soon as Timms comes in the ring, immediately they take over him. Don't even give him a chance to look at the bridge, look at the sky, nothing. Just take over on him immediately, which is fantastic. On that arm now. Now, this is what the Andersons brothers were famous for, and I believe that this tag team right here is kind of going by the same philosophy, but only. What do you think?
I would certainly have to agree with that hypothesis, Rod, because Ole Anderson is a well-known captain of any team that he comes involved in. They had and were the World Tag Team Champions for such a long period of time that I feel that Stan Hansen would certainly go in deference to Ole's experience as a tag team champion.
Yes, sir, absolutely right. And you notice Stan Hansen yelling there in the corner, give it up, give it up. They're talking to their opponent. That's almost like a bat catcher. You know, he's always saying, swing better. Here we go, 1, 2, 3, swing better. It's the same situation here. Hansen is yelling, look at that. Took the knee right off him. Elbow pad, threw it over here. It's absolutely perfect teamwork. Talk about vicious. Oh, beautiful, beautiful, beautiful.
The Andersons, of course, always like to concentrate on an arm, and they most generally pick a left arm because, as a rule, that would be the weaker of the two arms. And that's what they've been doing here with Timms now, really concentrating that with an inside arm bar high up on the deltoid. And so Timms has got some problems. He's lost the advantage of having that elbow pad. And they are out to punish him.
There is a rule here. I don't know whether people are aware of it, but when you're coming to wrestling equipment, you're talking elbow pads, knee pads. If one does fall off, one does come up, there is no reason to have the match stopped. It's strictly equipment. Your equipment should be right in the first place when you go in there, so there's no reason to stop this match.
Well, that's exactly right. And it is continuing at this point.
Ooh!
What a Hansen caught him like a freight train coming off those ropes. Drops that elbow on him once again, makes the tag with Ole Anderson. And Anderson closing in, and it appears to me, and I could stand corrected, but I think I'm correct, and there's the thing you were pointing out, is that Anderson allows them no surcease. As Gallagher tried to come into the ring, Anderson brought him into the ring forcibly, and has now continues his punishment. So they are, again, making an object lesson out of Timms and Gallagher.
That's right, because you're talking so much money here, they're trying to tell all the other wrestlers just what they're like. And can you notice, Mr. Soley, how finely tuned these teams are getting? They're getting better and better than I've ever seen tag teams before, and it's because of so much money. Ooh, money does funny things, doesn't it?
It does indeed. And it'll be interesting because next week we will have, as I said earlier, Jumbo Tsuruta and the Giant Baba here on television. And, caught him with a lariat. And that almost ripped the top of his head off.
Beautiful.
He has him for the count. He had him for the count all the way. But next week, as I said, of course, for the first time here on Georgia Championship Wrestling, we will have the Giant Baba, Jumbo Saruta, and a host of others. And, of course, we said, everybody keying and gearing themselves now for, of course, the worldwide tag team tournament. I want to take a moment, if I may, to talk to both...
belongs to you.
Well, I guess it might be a little trophy of our win here just a few moments ago. You know, I know a lot of people are wondering, what in the world are you doing with Stan Hansen? Well, I'll tell you, money talks. And when I talked about $25,000 every tournament that we can enter and every tournament that we can win, it doesn't take a whole lot of intelligence to realize that $25,000 is worth fighting for. Stan and I were probably the greatest tag team that Georgia's ever seen. We're going to be the greatest tag team that the world has ever seen. And you've just seen us now. Is there any question in your mind that we already are?
There is no question in my mind that you two are a very, very powerful tag team combination.
Hold it, Gordon. Hold it. If you don't mind me saying so, I'd just as soon have somebody like Mr. Piper interview me. Do you mind?
Pleasure.
Be my guest.
Step back, Gordon. Excuse me.
And I must say that I have never in my life seen a team more finely honed, more vicious, more to the point than you two gentlemen are. And in my mind, you are the top contenders in this tournament for $25,000.
You know, the thing is, everybody's asking me why. First of all, I don't know any of these stupid clay eaters, rednecks from Georgia or anywhere in the Southeast, an explanation for what I do. I do what I damn well want to, and I don't care what these goose out here say or anybody in anywhere across the country. He waved some money in front of me. That's why I'm here. We were successful. We're going to be successful. Stan Hansen and the Lariat, Ole Anderson, we were the Georgia Tag Team Champions, went all over the country defending that. We were together once successfully. We're back again. And as for all this mail they've been getting around here saying Stan Hansen's let everybody down.
You know, I tell you, when you go out for something as big as we're going for, you got to have somebody who's got the size, somebody who's got the ability, somebody who's got the guts and the determination. A lot of people just think they're wrestlers because they got on a pair of tights and a pair of boots.
Well,
when you see it, you know.
At the Omni, sir, we're going to find out for sure.
Oh, on the 28th, you're going to find out. Yep. They got the Briscoes, the Oriental Champions. They got the Funks. You're going to have the Armstrongs down there. Super D, Superstar, Understand Fuller and Brown, Ray's Kabuki, a whole bunch. Well, when the night's over and the smoke clears, you're going to be looking at $25,000 winners, and you're going to be looking at the new World Tag Team Champions.
And we'd like to remind you, too, about the great wrestling matches coming up Wednesday night, the 24th, in Key West. Don't forget the Omni on the 28th. Welcome. Welcome to another hour of Georgia Championship Wrestling, and during this next hour, we're going to be seeing Tommy Wildfire Rich in action. Also, the sensational Gino Hernandez. We'll be watching Kelly Kaniski, a second-generation wrestler and son of former world heavyweight champion Gene Kaniski. Kevin Sullivan will be in action. Bob and Brad Armstrong. And as you can see, Ron Bass and Buzz Sawyer have joined
me. Yes, sir, Mr. Soley. All kinds of things going on. All kinds. See, just like this guy right here getting in the ring, Tommy Rich. Tommy Rich, I've already wrestled you on TV, and if I remember correctly, I defeated him. Well, we'll get off that. Anyway, I'm tired of coming out here against these everybody nobodies. From now on, Mr. Soley, when you see me in the ring, I guess you would consider Tommy Rich somebody. I was in the ring with him, and if you remember correctly, he didn't like it too much. So I'm going to keep my eyes scouted and keep my eye open for this next hour. And if I see any so-called worthy opponents, I'm going to give them the privilege and the opportunity to wrestle Buzz Sawyer on Channel 17 and get beat right in the middle. 1, 2, 3, woo!
You know, Gordon, there's a lot of things been happening around here. I still got my undefeated record going, but there's people been sticking their nose in where it don't belong. And yes, somebody like this little Tommy Rich standing in the ring right now. You're one of the so-called dudes. Jim Garvin, you're another one, boys. You don't stick your nose in the Big Outlaws business without getting it chopped off. And you better believe that if it keeps happening, there's people's going to be paying, and you're going to be hurt, and you'll realize the penalty for sticking it in where it don't belong. Boys.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. I hear all sorts of challenges. Let's turn it to the ring right now. We have Tommy Wildfire Rich going up against Rick Harris, and, of course, Rod Piper has joined me here as Rich takes off his National Heavyweight Championship belt. This should be an interesting contest indeed, Rob.
Absolutely, Mr. Soley, and a pleasure to be here with you, Mr. Soley. But Sawyer out here, Big Ron Bass, they got so many great wrestlers here. Tommy Rich right in the ring there. Look at Mark, people are getting finer honed, these wrestlers are. Tommy Rich, the Phyllis Diller of professional wrestling. Yes, blonde hair flowing, women screaming. But you see, he should stop concentrating on all them women screaming and the blonde hair flowing and start to do just a little more wrestling. He may become a world champion if he could do that. He could become a Roddy Piper if he could do that.
Rich, of course, who held the World Heavyweight Championship at one point in his career, ducks away very nicely, catches Harris high backdrop. But Rich was set and ready, and Rich catches him a good arm drag takedown. Another arm drag takedown that has Harris rolling from the ring and outside to give himself a chance to regroup, if you will, and replan his strategy, because with Tommy Wildfire Rich, he'll wrestle just like a wildfire. It's hard to tell which direction he may be going to next.
Absolutely. It's just the same as the soldiers, right? But it's smart thinking. Now, I'm going to give you a little insight from an Olympic point of view. Mr. Wilhelm Ruschka, the world heavyweight judo champion in the Olympics, he told me one time he was having trouble in a match against a Russian. He said his foot was hurt. They gave him a break. They gave him time to recuperate, get his win back. And he told me, he said, you know, I knew later on down the way in the record book it wasn't going to say I had to take a break. It just said Wilhelm Ruschka is the judo champion. Well, so what's wrong with Harris taking a dip out of the ring there and catching his breath?
Ruschka was quite an opponent. I had the opportunity of watching him compete professionally several times, and he is an outstanding competitor. But here we're seeing Tommy Wildfire Rich trying to put up with some rather unwieldy and unsavory tactics on the part of one Rick Harris, and it is Scrappy McGowan, the referee, now trying to get Mr. Harris straightened out.
And the referee doing a magnificent job here. But look at this, Rick Harris is really coming along fine, because Tommy Rich isn't someone that just can fall for these things that is happening to him, having his hair pulled. But the thing is here, can Tommy Rich hold a stemper, Mr. Soley? Can he hold a stemper, or is he going to lose it and make mistakes? That's the thing I'd like to see right now.
Up into a top wrist lock. And by the way, Rod, I was just handed a note, and it seems as though Mr. Garvin has taken umbrage to some of the comments made by Mr. Bass and Mr. Sawyer, and it looks like we may be seeing Buzz Sawyer against Jim Garvin later on in the program, and that...
TV?
That would be quite a match indeed.
That would be quite a match indeed, and a very expensive match for the promoters to put on TV. I doubt that it'll happen, but I would really like to see it.
Well, that's one thing about Paul Jones, our promoter. He always tries to bring the very, very best to the people, and...
If he does this, I'm sorry, Mr. Sawyer, but if he does this, he will be bringing the best. Look at Tommy Rich going.
Harden coming off the ropes, used that elbow very effectively, and Rich closes in on him again, drives the fist into the head of Rick Harris, and the referee warning him, but Tommy Rich tiring of the tactics of Harris and retaliating very quickly in kind.
Good recuperative cover, good recuperative properties rather on Harris's part there, because Rich does hit hard. Oh, very good, 280 pounds there. Now we're going to see also how much punishment can Tommy Rich take here. Can you think while you're hurt, Mr. Rich?
And it is Harris continuing to punish Tommy Rich now. Brings Rich up into a full body slam.
Mr. Soley, Rich being the national heavyweight champion, does he qualify still to get a partner and go for the world tag team titles? Can you hold both at the same time?
Well, that would be an interesting thing. I don't think he could manage both commitments at once. He would have to vacate one or the other.
I see.
Rich now, a series of short chopping right hands, now one to the side of the head of Harris. Now the elbow to the prefrontal lobe on Harris, drops Harris to the canvas once again. Rich drops into a lateral press.
Oh.
Harris able to power out once again before the count of three.
He's working on instinct. Harris is working on instinct now, Mr. Foley. Now Rich should be digging in now, trying to finish his opponent off. Don't let him get you to the ropes, Rich. Wrestle like Roddy Piper. Think.
Keeping the side headlock, Tommy Wildfire Rich. Harris fires him off. Rich slips through his leg very nicely that time. Vertical body block. Has the count of three. It is all over. Tommy Wildfire Rich defeating Rick Harris. Ron Bass moving out against Jim Gallagher. Now, this match also one fall with a 10-minute time limit. And here you have two men with very much the same methodology in the ring. Both men, and Bass wastes no time at all exploding on Gallagher. Interestingly, I was talking to Gene Gordon, a writer and photographer for Wrestling News, and quite a story in the latest edition about TV wrestling. And it is Gallagher caught coming off, and Bass planted that size 16 right at the belt line, and Gallagher driven back to the canvas. The Outlaw Ron Bass undefeated thus far here on Georgia Championship Wrestling, and just has a tremendous win streak going. Gallagher hurtled outside the ring to the concrete floor. Gallagher coming up very slowly. You can see him now favoring the lower section of his spine down around the lumbar region. Forearm across the chest on Gallagher once again. Again, Ron Bass explodes across the chest. Snap mare. Was into the ropes. Was into the ropes, and the referee, good judicious decision on the part of the referee. And Gallagher now begins to retaliate on Bass, and Gallagher showing that he is made of stern stuff indeed, but he is caught again in rock and dropped down to one knee by a massive forearm at the end of Ron Bass. Bass now using the flat of the foot so very effectively. Now has him in a variation of a sickle. And notice, although he does not cover the mouth and the nose completely, it is not a smother. It is so very close to it that Gallagher is going to have a lot of trouble with intake. And again, the referee warning Bass. Headlock now on, face lock on Gallagher by Bass. Gallagher in the green trunks, having his problems, fires one, sort of an uppercut, if you will, into the midsection. Now Bass catches him with that forearm again. Atomic knee drop on Gallagher. That jams the spine. And again, Gallagher, utilizing those ring ropes, forces the break. And so Bass has this man completely at his mercy. And Bass again continues to punish Gallagher. Gallagher has a lot of grit, a lot of determination, a lot of perseverance, because he has been beaten down to that mat repeatedly by Bass. And Bass, like so many other wrestlers of late, does not allow his man the opportunity of being pinned, brings him up to administer even more punishment.
Oh, and notice the way he's hanging on to the hair now. The referee is counting, but he's being careful what he's doing. I mean, truly, what you say is humiliating and punishing this man beyond a shadow of a doubt. He is trying to tell other wrestlers something, and this is when someone comes to a national television show like that. There's so many people watching, so many scouts, Mr. Soley, that he's just being brutal. That's all there is to it. But then again, it's a brutal sport, isn't it?
Well, all sports, of course, all body contact sports have that element, and they have that added element of danger to where injury can become very prevalent. Bass, of course, I don't think is as much worried about his win streak since he was disqualified once. I don't think his win streak concerns him anymore, as long as he can now punish people and show them what's in store for them when they step into the squared circle against him.
Absolutely, and it shows you what a competitor that Bass is, because he's not going to let, I believe he got disqualified one time, so his win streak has been marred. I think he's not going to let that bother him. The true sign of a champion, as we said, is someone who can get up like Roddy Piper and do it again and do it again. And this man right here has the same qualifications. He's a tremendous, whoa, look at that.
There's the stampede, and that is off the road for one Mr. Jim Gallagher. And it is Ron Bass once again emerging victorious in his match. And so he has returned to his winning ways. But nonetheless, you can see Gallagher being assisted to his feet at this time. Let's talk about February 28th at the Omni here in Atlanta. Of course, the beginning $25,000 going to the winner that night of this first round of the World Tag Team Tournament.
Look out, Omni. You know, a few years back, I won a brand new Cadillac in that, Omni. Last Thanksgiving, Brad and I won the national tag titles. Now we're talking about world-class tag championships coming to the Omni. Coming from all over. The best that Japan has to offer. World Championship night. Dragon Shy, is that what they call it? Dragon Shy match. I got a little of everything that night.
And, of course, on March 8th, you're going on tour.
That's it, brother. I'm headed north. Look out, Lansing, Toledo, all up through there. Georgia Championship is coming north.
And we certainly hope all of you in this viewing area watch for Georgia Championship Wrestling. Championship Wrestling will be held tonight in Carroll.
It's a super wrestling spectacular Sunday night, February 28th, at the Omni in Atlanta. The beginning of the World Tag Team Tournament. $25,000 goes to the winning team. Here are the teams that have entered. Jack and Jerry Briscoe, the Superstar and Super D. Bob and Brad Armstrong, Dory and Terry Funk. Ole Anderson and Stan Hansen, Buzz Sawyer and Ron Bass, Ron Fuller and Bad Bad Leroy Brown, Tenru and the Jumbo Saruda, and you'll see the return of the Mongolian Stomper. In a special Dragon Shy match, it will be the Great Kabuki, managed by Gary Hart, going up against the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. The Pacific Federation Championship match, the Giant Baba defends his title against Terry Gordy. And then NWA World Heavyweight Champion, Ric Flair defends his title against the former champion, Harley Race. All of this great action takes place Sunday night, February 28th, at the Omni in Atlanta.
And, of course, tomorrow you're going to be busy. You're going to be in Columbus, Dayton, and Raleigh.
I'm going to be at Carrollton tonight, but the big thing is I'm going on the Northern Tour again. Columbus, Ohio, looking forward to coming. Dayton, Ohio, and Huntington, West Virginia. And, you know, I've also been getting a lot of mail from Grand Rapids, Toledo, Ohio, Lansing, and I'm really looking forward to going all up through the Northern area. And this is why the National Heavyweight title, and as far as Eugene Hernandez, anytime, any place, Daddy, you name it, and I'll be there, brother.
There you have it. Jim Garvin in the ring waiting now for Buzz Sawyer.
Does Garvin think he is? He thinks he's another Tommy Rich. I'm going to beat him just like I did Tommy Rich.
Oh. Well, we'll find out. Sawyer was out here making comments. A challenge has been issued, and so we're going to be seeing, and this would, fill a stadium anywhere, Jim Garvin against Buzz Sawyer, two top-flight athletes. Drop toe hold by Sawyer, but Garvin slips away. Garvin back on his feet. Fireman carry takedown by Sawyer, and it is now Sawyer with a ride, but Garvin escapes. And Garvin, and now Sawyer rolls out to the concrete. And so you saw there, for those of you who are amateur wrestlers, you saw an excellent example there of how quickly and how efficiently a fireman carry can be executed. Buzz Sawyer, beautiful job there, but an excellent ride by Jim Garvin. And Mr. Sawyer finally chose to leave the ring in order to regroup. Now they're getting set to square off once again. And Sawyer complaining to the referee.
I can't believe the intensity here, and if the people understand it, putting this on national television, these two men, both of them have everything to lose and losing a match here on national television. They're going for ratings. Look at them. Look at them. They're fighting. They're doing nothing but digging in and fighting. Neither one of them is afraid. Now, didn't molest a referee like that. The referee is a good official there. He realizes the intensity of the competition. He has given him a warning, but he did not disqualify him. Very, very good. Very, very good.
Buzz Sawyer pulling down those straps on his wrestling tunic, and now it is Jim Garvin circling him once again. They meet up. It's collar and elbow into a side headlock by Jim Garvin. Now, Garvin, the cooler head of the two. Garvin does not lose his cool as quickly as Sawyer. This may serve him well later in the match. Garvin comes off the ropes, a good shoulder smash. And again, side cradle by Garvin. One, two. No, came out of it.
I thought it was three.
Well, he had him too, and that's where Garvin was ahead of his man, Human Chess. He had his had himself figured.
Human Chess, exactly right, Mr. Soley. And right there, it was so close, I believe he took just a little of the confidence out of Sawyer there. When you get a count that close on something so important as this, it does. Oh! Shows you what an athlete. He comes right back.
Sawyer last out. Garvin catches him a backslide. He's got those shoulders down, too. No, sir. And that's where Sawyer has such tremendous body strength. But Sawyer now beginning to become a study of frustration as Garvin is just outthinking him.
You know, Mr. Soley, you were absolutely right. You predicted this far before it happened. Sawyer is losing his temper. Garvin is keeping his head. Consequently, Garvin is thinking faster, and he's got three close counts now that I've seen, and I noticed Sawyer hopping out of the ring. So very, very good deduction. Very, very good, Mr. Sawyer.
Into those. That time Sawyer closes in, and Sawyer now the forearm across into the chest. Has Garvin in trouble. Rocks him again and again. Garvin reverses on Sawyer. Got him coming off into a hip lock takedown.
What wrestling? What wrestling?
Great competition between these two. A lot of personal pride involved here. And as high a level of intensity as I've ever seen.
And the people realize that the whole of the United States of America right now is watching this. This goes from coast to coast. These guys have something to prove. They all want to be top-ranked fighters. And I can't believe, first of all, I can't believe that they put a match like this on TV.
Check the referee, Strappy McGowan, checking those shoulders again very carefully. Strappy, a fine young official, very conscientious. By the way, we're going to be seeing the son of former world heavyweight champion Gene Kaniski in action a little bit later on, Kelly Kaniski. And there's a great athlete and a young man who's got a tremendous future. He just came back from an extensive tour of Japan, and he was telling me, of course, that there is a tremendous amount of talk throughout the entire country of Japan about the World Tag Team Tournament. And, of course, they have sent the Giant Baba, Jumbo Tsuruta, and others here to the United States after having won preliminaries in Osaka, Japan, which I found very interesting. So
they're the ones who won the preliminaries.
That's right, in Osaka.
I didn't know that. That's very good. Very good. Here comes Ron Dow. Little encouragement there. Little encouragement there. He's got a friend. He's doing nothing but encouraging. Good, good, good. What intensity.
Jim Garvin keeping that side headlock on Buzz Sawyer and Bass. Well, that means that Scrappy McGowan's job has become a little more difficult now. Into the turnbuckle now is Buzz Sawyer.
I'm trying to allow you. I'm trying to get closer. You can hear what they're saying. The encouragement that Ron Bass is giving to Buzz Sawyer is incredible here. He's got to uplift him, and right now Buzz is in full control.
And it's Garvin smashed into that turnbuckle. He's got some problems, and Garvin slipping away at this time, sort of on his bicycle, caught again. A forearm into the side of the jaw. Garvin is down and into those ring ropes, and it is Sawyer closing in. And so Sawyer has begun to really unleash some heavy artillery on Jim Garvin. And Garvin now much the worse for wear, taking a lot more punishment. A full body slam by Buzz Sawyer. Sawyer eyes his man. You can see the gleam of victory in his eye as he crashes down into the forehead with his knee. Bass continues to shout encouragement, and Sawyer, as Rod Piper just said, is dominating the picture.
Absolutely. Sawyer right now is taking, I think, a little too much time. He should be trying. Whoa! What a counter! What a counter! Look at it! He's got a three count!
Had the three! Jim Garvin had the three, but now he's been Pearl Harbored from behind by Ron Bass. And Buzz Sawyer. Buzz Sawyer caught by Garvin for the count. But they are now, the two of them, punishing Jim Garvin. And it is Ron Bass. Came down, and now Garvin facing tremendous punishment from both Ron Bass and Buzz Sawyer as they have double teamed. They were going to have to try and get some sort of order restored here. Here comes the Tom Pritchard, Brad Armstrong.
I was going to help, but my rib is a little sore, Mr. Soley.
And Garvin, when he came down off that top rope, opened up a severe laceration on Jim Garvin. He may have a broken nose.
You know, it's getting to where this stuff's completely uncalled for. Last week, a couple of weeks ago at the Omni, saw you wanted to run in on my match. Last week, Bass took a kid just breaking into the wrestling business and like to beat the daylights out of him. Today, it took 2-on-1. Bass Sawyer, that's a very good friend of mine, brother. We go way, way back. So I'm telling you something, and you take it for what it's worth. Anytime, any place, anywhere that Garvin or myself, either one, see you, we're going to make it our business
to take care of some business. And when I say take care of business, you better believe what that, you know, it's sickness what it is. It's completely uncalled for. Bass, you know, just like I said last time, there's some low-down people around, and the two that's on my list is Buzz Sawyer and Ron Bass.
Well, the die is cast, and the challenge is there. We'll be back. Bobby Garrett moving up now against Kelly Kaniski. Kelly Kaniski from Vancouver, British Columbia, the son of former world heavyweight champion Gene Kaniski. Kelly, by the way, interestingly enough, 260 pounds, had his final education at West Texas State. Now, West Texas State has turned out a tremendous level of professional athletes. Garrett misses with a right hand, and it is Kaniski with a quick arm drag takedown and another one. Kaniski moves with great speed and agility for a man of 260 pounds.
Absolutely. That's what makes him so dangerous, and he is from Canada. I know his father. I've wrestled his father before, Gene Kaniski. So, you know, obviously everybody has heard of Gene Kaniski, world champion. He's got quite a thing to follow here, but this young man, one of the things he had that Gene didn't is I think he's a little more agile than his father. He's a touch heavier, I believe, at this particular stage of his career than his father was. Do you think so, Mr. Soli?
I'd have to go back to my memory bank on that one, Rod. I'll tell you, I've watched Gene Kaniski when he was a world heavyweight champion.
Mm-hmm.
One of the all-time greats, no question about it. And he has raised Kelly in obviously a very, very proper way. And, of course, has brought to him that sense of sportsmanship and fair play.
Mm-hmm.
He is extremely agile, and he could be maybe a shade faster than his dad, although his dad is still running 3 to 5 miles a day.
Yes, but yes, he certainly is. And another thing kind of interest here is he just came back from Japan, you see. Now, technique in Japan is much different, and so you apply that to the wrestling when you get here. If you have different techniques, then the wrestlers that you have here that aren't enjoying that same privilege of being educated that way, then in that particular sense, he has an advantage over this particular opponent. Also, wrestling with some of the Japanese boys, they're a little smaller, they're a little faster, and you need to wrestle with fast boys. Oh, a mistake. Mistake there on Kaniski's part. If you wrestle with fast young guys, you become faster. Then you wrestle with heavy, strong guys, you become stronger. Then you have it all down like I do.
Kaniski missed with that dropkick. Garrett very quickly took advantage of that. Came up, and there's where the strength of Kaniski paid off.
Yes.
Caught Garrett mid-flight, brought him up. And boy, has he got him hog-tied now. He had him all the way on that one. By the way, I just received word a moment ago that coming in for them from the Northwest and will be here next week here on Georgia Championship Wrestling, Rick Oliver and Buddy Rhodes, another great tag team combination. So the World Tag Team Tournament is certainly drawing competitors from everywhere. We said, of course, we did have the Japanese team that we'll be seeing who won their preliminary in Osaka, Japan. Gino Hernandez is scheduled to wrestle, and obviously, Mr. Hernandez, you're certainly not in wrestling togs here at all.
Well, with the initials G.G. Hernandez, some people misinterpret that as generous Gino. It's gorgeous Gino, and I think I've been overly generous by wrestling nationwide a couple of times here now. I've come to the conclusion that it is now time for me to sit back and tell the people, if you want to see my body, if you want to see the handsome half-breed, you're going to have to pay to see me.
I have a question, Mr. Soli,
sure.
If you wouldn't mind. How is Farrah doing?
Oh, well, thank you for asking. She's fine. She's in L.A. She sends her love to you, by the way.
Isn't that nice? You see, a young fella like Gino Hernandez does not have to prove himself on national TV. You have proven yourself all over America. You are one of the greatest, youngest scientific wrestlers I have ever seen. And I can see your point not wanting to prove yourself in front of people. What for?
There's nothing really to prove, I don't think. Do you?
Not
I mean, honestly. I just like to say, you know.
Yeah, really.
I mean, it's really nonsense is what it is. But I'd like to say to you, the people, if you think I'm punishing you by not letting you see the body, you're right. All the women out there, I'd like to say, keep your hands off my body in the airport. Keep off of me. Leave me alone.
Yeah.
And I'd like to say to the wildfire, Tommy Rich, start sweating because all your entourage is slowly but surely
diminishing. It is slowly but surely diminishing. And I am the handsome half-breed, gorgeous Gene Hernandez, and you, Tommy Rich, your days are numbered. So start sweating and start crying, brother.
Bravo, bravo.
I want to take a moment right now to talk to Kevin Sullivan. We're going to be seeing him in action in just a couple of moments, but he is, we've talked about intensity, and here's a young man that has an overabundance of it.
You know, that's right, Gord. You know, I've heard guys come out here and talk about that they're great athletes, you know, that they're the best all-around athlete. And, you know, we were talking trivia back there, me and you. You know, there's been a few people that's been able to play two sports, like Dave DeBuscher played baseball and played professional basketball. Gene Conley a few years ago did the same thing. But nobody in the world has ever succeeded in being the top in three, and I have. I've won bodybuilding titles, hold the world's weightlifting record, and I am the top in the field today. I don't have to talk about my body. The people can just look and see. They see the top conditioned athlete in the world today, whether I'm in Augusta, Columbus, Ohio, Columbus, Georgia, Chattanooga. It doesn't matter to me, Gordon. And I want to get back to one thing. You know, here, finally justice was served. Jimmy Garvin, the little punk that he is, got what he deserved. You know, he's been edging Buzz Sawyer on, edging him on. And finally, the buzzsaw shut him up. Because Garvin, he's from the same mold that guys like Tommy Rich, the Armstrongs, I call them the clones. You know what they remind me of? The Leave It to Beaver series. The little one's the Beaver and the bigger one's Wally. They go around bumping into each other. They have no concept of what's happening. This, guys like Rich, the Armstrongs, and Garvin have no comprehension. This is where it's at today. This is the hotbed of wrestling. This is Georgia. I don't have to say anything more.
Well, I think he summed that up. I do not necessarily agree with his philosophical views, but nonetheless, I feel that he certainly has a right to say them, and he is unquestionably a highly successful professional athlete. Let's see him in action now in the ring as he goes up against Alan Tuffarello. Now, Tuffarello, originally from Long Island, New York, and so he knows well of Kevin Sullivan's background. Sullivan had quite an amateur background from Massachusetts, and be curious if Mr. Piper would coincide his thinking with that of Mr. Sullivan, that Mr. Garvin got what he had coming. I found that a rather interesting observation.
Well, it was in the intensity of the match. What's that young fellow's name?
Buzz Sawyer?
Not Buzz Sawyer, the fellow that just beat Buzz Sawyer. What's his name again?
Well, we're referring, of course, to Garvin and
Garvin, Sawyer. That's the young fellow's name. You see, now everybody else is going to remember his name. I don't, because he's not significant to me in my category. But now on national TV, he's just embarrassed Buzz Sawyer, and Buzz Sawyer just did something about it. Buzz Sawyer said to Garvin, he says, "You're not going to embarrass me no more." And he's not, because now Garvin's nose is bashed up. He's got a nice cauliflower on his ear. So all it was a battle. He was a little mad that he lost. And in the intensity of the battle, they just kept going. That's all. That's wrestling. They can't help it. When you're fighting, you're fighting.
And it is Sullivan now pressing that advantage on Tuffarello. So Mr. Tuffarello in the blue trunks is getting a lesson indeed. And now Sullivan opens up across the chest. Sullivan has indeed been highly successful in three professional sports. And it is Sullivan continuing to press his advantage now on Tuffarello, keeping the pressure on him. All right. The rear chin lock, and Tuffarello using that elbow effectively. Now it's a Boston Battler.
Back to the same old. You hear people yelling sleeper, but it shows you that they don't really know what they're talking about. They like to see them put the sleeper on, but this man is not set up for the sleeper. He's not set in the right position, and Sullivan is not trying to set him up for a sleeper hold. So you can't, you know, when people say, well, do the fans bother you? No, because you don't listen to them. At least I don't listen to the fans. So they don't bother me at all, because they don't know what they're talking about. And now, if I wanted to talk about my spark plugs in my car, I would talk to the fans. I wanted to talk about getting fixed by a doctor. I talk to the fans wrestling. I talk to me, because I know about wrestling. Nice. Sullivan, very aggressive. completely under control, shows his true professionalism because he does not hurry. He keeps himself perfectly under control. Now watch this, watch this. Boom. A little dangerous and backing up to throw a punch from an opponent because of the blocking aspect, but still very effective for Kevin Sullivan.
Sullivan has reddened the entire upper body of Tafarello now with the impact of all of those percussion blows to the body, and Sullivan now driving his man, and Tafarello, those blows glancing off the very, very rigid abdominis erecti muscles of Sullivan, and I don't think that anyone's going to accomplish a whole lot by going after the midsection of one Kevin Sullivan.
No, no, no. He's extremely well conditioned there. And one of the things that, some of the things that I do, and Kevin Sullivan does also, is you have the medicine ball thrown against the stomach continuously, which conditions yourself for those balls. Yes, he says he has. Are you saying nice things? How can you not say nice things about Kevin Sullivan? Look at the body on him. He's got a squat record, 425 pounds, 26 times. He's nothing but all athlete and all wrestler.
Well, he is indeed. Speaking about, you've mentioned, of course, your workout regimens, Ron. I wonder if perhaps one day, sometime in the future, if we could invade your privacy, so to speak, to catch you in a workout session and film it. I think the fans would be very interested in seeing how you do work out.
Well, sir, it would truly be a pleasure. One of the reasons I would not do that is because not to give any of my strategy away to any of my other opponents. However, some of the things, like throwing heavy the medicine ball against my stomach, like Kevin Sullivan has, and wrestling with different people, certainly. And I thank you for asking me that. That's well, quite fine of you, sir.
Thank you, and we'll certainly leave you the editorial rights on that, so that you only show what you care to have shown. But I think the fans would be very interested in seeing how you do train. And right now, there's no question about a question here. Conditioning has to be such a vital factor.
Yes.
And Tafarello is finding it out. He is finding out that Sullivan is fantastically conditioned.
Perfect condition. He's not even taking a hard breath. Look at that. He's complete control.
And quite a victory indeed for Kevin Sullivan. I might point out Sullivan at about 218, he'll range from 218 to about 226. Here you see him bringing his man up. Again, those muscles being wrenched and pulled, slams him back to the canvas. Now watch this, about 220 pounds directly into the midsection of Tafarello. And of course, from that point on, the pinfall becomes rather academic. On Sunday, February 28th at the Omni here in Atlanta, a Dragon Shy match between the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, and the Great Kabuki.
Would like to say, you people today had an opportunity to see what Kabuki can do with the bamboo sticks. What happened here today will be nothing compared to what happens in the Omni. Because Dusty Rhodes, we've got two things for you. First of all, we have the stick. But also, I have a special surprise for you. That is what's coming at you, baby. There is no DQs. Everything is legal. We're going to beat you like we own you, believe
it. Wrestling will be held tonight in Carrollton at the West Georgia Sports Center, and then 2:30. It's a super wrestling spectacular Sunday night, February 28th at the Omni in Atlanta. The beginning of the World Tag Team Tournament. $25,000 goes to the winning team. Here are the teams that have entered. Jack and Jerry Briscoe, the Superstar and Super D. Bob and Brad Armstrong, Dory and Terry Funk. Ole Anderson and Stan Hansen, Buzz Sawyer and Ron Bass. Ron Fuller and Bad Bad Leroy Brown. Tenru and the Jumbo Saruta. And you'll see the return of the Mongolian Stomper. In a special Dragon Shy match, it will be the Great Kabuki, managed by Gary Hart, going up against the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. The Pacific Federation Championship match, the Giant Baba defends his title against Terry Gordy. And then NWA World Heavyweight Champion, Ric Flair, defends his title against the former champion, Harley Race. All of this great action takes place Sunday night, February 28th at the Omni in Atlanta.
Tonight, of course, the superstar will be in Carrollton.
Well, it's going to start in Carrollton. We're going to go to Dayton, Ohio, Columbus, Ohio, Huntington, West Virginia. But everything's boiling down to this big tag team tournament. You're looking at the national tag team champions. All these individuals get out there and they say, we're tough, we're the best. Well, if you were the best, fellas, you'd have these belts. We don't care if it is Stan Hansen or Ole Anderson. We don't care if it's Tommy Rich. Whoever you put in that ring, the Japanese team, the Russian team, we're the champions and we're going to prove it.
You know, no matter where you happen to be viewing this program from, may I assure you that, of course, the worldwide tag team tournament events are taking place all over the world. The Japanese team, the Saruta and Baba winning over in Osaka, Japan.
That is not the point.
Jimmy Garvin's out here belly aching. Tommy Rich is out here running his mouth. And you're talking about tag team. I don't want no tag team. Forget the tag team, Garvin. It's you and me. I'll fight you here. I'll fight you all around the world. I don't care where it's at. I'm sick and tired of it. And Garvin, you think I left you laying now, baby? You're messing with the wrong piece of meat.
Well, there's a highly embarrassed Buzz Sawyer, and I have to say, and I think you'd have to agree, it took Sawyer and Bass after Garvin got a pinfall.
Yes, it did, and he did some damage to a young athlete, a fine athlete, who did get a 1-2-3 in the middle. He was pinned, but now we've got a little aggression, and now when they wrestle, it's going to be a little different, I think. It's not going to be quite the same sportsmanship.
I certainly agree with that. By the way, next week, another tag team will be seen here in action, Rick Oliver and pretty boy Buddy Rose. So,
I know them.
Yeah, they've wrestled out where you've wrestled a lot up in the Great Northwest.
Yes, I have. And they are a very good team, and I'll be anxious to see Buddy Rose, but he won't be anxious to see me.
All right, Rod Piper with us here, and now we're getting set for some tag team competition. What's Bob and Brad Armstrong against...
Well, now, isn't this nice? What do we have here? Has Daddy managed to control his temper? I know that I've seen families have little kids that have temper tantrums, and they got to console them a little bit. Has Daddy finished, you think?
Well, Mr. Piper, a good front chancery by Brad Armstrong, and Benfield made it to the ring ropes and forced the break. But the feelings between you and the Armstrongs are good. Good drop-toe variation. Good ride by Armstrong, too, back into a chancery. And this time he allowed him the opportunity to tag up a Chick Donovan. And so the Golden Boy moves in, and now Bob Armstrong moves in.
Oh, yes, here comes what? Jump in the nearest phone booth, change into your Superman costume, and come on out here, Mr. Armstrong. But then again, I shouldn't knock him, you see, because it took three or four wrestlers to pull me off Bob Armstrong at the last Atlanta Omni. So I guess I shouldn't knock someone lesser than me, should I? That's not fair of me. And I'm a fair, wonderful man.
Good block by Armstrong, and caught Donovan to the side of the head that time, right alongside the eye socket. And now it's Bob Armstrong having the rear chin lock on Donovan, keeps the pressure on him.
Did you notice no comments are thrown my way anymore? And Bob Armstrong hasn't said a thing to me, has not even looked at me, possibly because of the fear I bring to him. Maybe he just knows that he stepped out of his league, and I suppose a man can make a mistake like that, right? When you just, mouth gets just a little too much, and you just jump right in there, and before you know it, you're way out of your league, and you're fighting Roddy Piper. So I won't mention it no more.
Fair enough. Snap mare variation by Brad Armstrong, and Armstrong moving very quickly now against Benfield. Keeps the pressure on him with an arm bar. It's an Australian tag team event. One fall with television time remaining. Down to a bottom wrist lock and up against those ring ropes. And Benfield caught him, one in the midsection. Coming out of that and drives that knee to the midsection again. Brad Armstrong might be well served at this point to get over and tag up with Bob Armstrong.
Perfect, absolutely perfect. And here, again, I notice even with the Armstrongs, the teamwork, because of $25,000 world championship, the teamwork has even got better with the Armstrongs. These tag teams are going to be something. These tag teams are really going to be something. The Golden Boy coming on, going for a nice suplex. Very good. Covers. Grab a leg. That's what he's doing wrong. He's not hooking the leg when you see Stop Gunning.
Valid point by Rod Piper, because chances are that Donovan hooked that leg. Armstrong could not have gotten the leverage to break that shoulder free.
Right.
And now Brad Armstrong has an opportunity to possibly battle his way back over to that corner and make that very necessary tag. And he gets over there. The tag is made. Bob Armstrong now in control of the situation, and Benfield beginning to feel the power of the Armstrongs.
Not terrific sportsmanship on Armstrong's part there. Bob Armstrong grabbing his opponent from behind by the hair even before the tag. But nevertheless, he's trying, I guess.
Donovan moves back out into the squared circle now. Donovan in the black trunks. Bulls Armstrong back into the turnbuckle. And it's Donovan. Uncorks a hard right hand. Reversal there. Good hip toss by Armstrong. Armstrong hurdles Donovan into his corner. Brad Armstrong catches him, makes the tag, and now it's Brad Armstrong moving into the ring. Drop kick by Armstrong as Donovan to the canvas once again. Hip lock takedown and keeps the... And it's Donovan with the head scissors.
Yes, an absolutely very nice drop kick. Takes him down, but what they miss him is you're trying to pin your man. He had the man hurt there for a second. He hit him with a drop kick. Jump on him, grab a leg, and try to pin him. Otherwise, you're wasting your time. Good chance. Good time to tag, though, for Brad Armstrong.
Yeah, come on, Daddy. What can you do? I know what you can do.
Armstrong uncorks the right hand, and he's been tiring of some of the tactics by Benfield and Donovan, and so Armstrong now beginning to retaliate in kind. Armstrong, of course, who's had some extensive martial arts training, is able to utilize it and combine it with catch-as-catch-can wrestling, much to his own advantage.
Absolutely, and here comes tagging Brad again. Brad being fresh comes in. Nice move. A move that I invented myself. Double leg to the face. That long time ago. Beautiful move by Brad again. Now he's going for the pin. Now he's hooking a leg. Didn't quite hook it fast enough.
Benfield powered away from that. Armstrong now keeps that side headlock, and now Chick Donovan gets into the situation. Hooks Armstrong's arms, and Benfield quickly takes advantage of that. The count was on. They broke. Now they're back at it again, double-teaming on Brad Armstrong. And Mr. Armstrong has some problems.
The fellas are getting vicious, very vicious here. And that's what they have to do to beat this team, because after all, now, again, I'm not comparing these Armstrongs to me, because you can't do that. I'm in a different category. But they are a tough team, and they're going to have to get right on top of them. This Golden Boy here has really become aggressive as we've watched them through the weeks. Now they're getting smart. They're tagging and not letting one man, one partner get tired. Very good.
And Brad Armstrong ducked away that time, and Donovan caught it from Benfield. And so Donovan shaking his head, trying to get cleared up. And now, again, they're double-teaming on Brad Armstrong, going to the midsection now. And they continue to double-team. And now Bob Armstrong explodes on the scene, and we've got a four-way pier sixer going. And again, they're double-teaming.
What's wrong now? What's wrong with that? That was my son in there now, brother. I want you to know those two men would not be standing now.
Tag is made, and Bob Armstrong moves out, and Armstrong explodes on Benfield and Donovan. Smashes their heads together. Donovan off to one side of the ring, and now here comes Brad Armstrong. And so the Armstrongs, the father and son tag team combination, look like they're about ready to clean house as they hurtle both men into each other. And it continues to be Bob Armstrong with a full body slam, Brad Armstrong a hooking right hand. Bob Armstrong again has Benfield. And Bob Armstrong, the legal man in the ring, has the pinfall. And so some great tag team action here as Bob and Brad Armstrong took the measure on Rick Benfield and the Golden Boy, Chick Donovan, in the closing moments here on Georgia Championship Wrestling. And once again, as we said, of course, next week, we will have Buddy Rose and Rick Oliver here on Georgia Championship Wrestling. We'll also be seeing Jumbo Saruta, the Giant Baba. And I want to ask Ole Anderson right now if he and Stan Hansen will be back in action next week.
Well, we might. We just don't want to give all of our secrets away. I don't think it's right for people to watch us and be able to take notes and view and see how we wrestle. They know. It's enough to know that Henderson and Hansen are probably the best, not probably, are the best tag team right now in wrestling. You look out here, and I see the former national champions, the Armstrongs. Everybody talks about them. They yell, and they jump it down. The little kids get all excited and think that the Armstrongs are really great. Well, if you put the Armstrongs against me, you're going to find out that the Armstrongs aren't so great. We already found out that we've got one with a big yellow streak down his back, because when Piper got a hold of him, he decided to take off someplace, and Piper's still after him, trying to figure out how to get one final match out of Bob Armstrong. But I guarantee you, if Armstrong's got any brains, and I doubt there are very few, he won't give that match to Piper.
No.
Don't blame him. Don't blame him.
Great wrestling. Brains right here, intelligence, coordination, world tag team brains, and the greatest manager in the world, Mr. Gary Hart.
You know what I think a terrible shame is? That this man for years represented America as the tag team champions. And I want to make a prediction just to show that I'm not a fool. When it's all said and done, and all the tournaments are over in Ohio and up through the Carolinas and West Virginia, the team that is going to be number one is going to be one Ole Anderson and one Stan Hansen.
Gary, Gary, thank you very much. You know, I'll tell you, a guy like Gary can't be wrong, and I might be able now to reciprocate by saying to you, when the match comes down to you
And a man that we call the American Dream. Well, I don't think there's any doubt in my mind what the conclusion is going to be. I saw Kabuki out here. I'm like Piper. I'm like so many people. I was really impressed and amazed.
Bravo. Gentlemen, our time is completely gone. Confidence running him up. Till next week. So long.
The announcers on this program are employed by Georgia Championship Wrestling Incorporated.